Hello and welcome back to Reading Reveries, where you and I together lose ourselves in a little bit of reading for the next few minutes. And I am your host, Kasturi. In commemoration of VE Day and Mother's Day this week, I thought of choosing a literary piece that talks about motherhood and the horrors of the Holocaust. Published in the May 26, 1980 issue of The New Yorker, Cynthia Ozick's short story, The Shawl, is a brilliant yet harrowing piece rich with passion and compassion. Cynthia Ozick was born in 1928 in New York City. Her parents had come to the United States from northwestern Russia. Ozick considered herself a feminist and claimed she became one at the age of five when her grandmother took her to Heder, a school for the study of Hebrew and the Torah. The rabbi told Ozick's grandmother to take her home, since a girl doesn't have to study. Ozick returned the next day and quickly established herself as a good student. Ozick's short story, The Shawl, introduces us to Rosa, the mother of a baby girl hidden within a tattered cloth, and a 14-year-old niece, Stella, as they attempt to survive the horrors of life in a Nazi death camp. Cold, exhausted, starving, they live in a place without pity, where the struggle for the most basic necessities can have terrible consequences. When Stella warms herself with the shawl, she unwittingly begins a chain of events that leads to her infant cousin's death. In an interview, Ozick says, quote, "The Shawl began with a line, one sentence in The Rise and Fall of the Third Reich by William Scherer. This one sentence told of a real event, about a baby being thrown against an electrified fence. And that stayed with me and stayed with me, and that was the very explicit origin of the shawl. It began with those very short 5 pages. We read now and again that a person sits down to write and there's a sense that some mystical hand is guiding you and you're not writing out of yourself. I think reasonably, if you're a rational person, you can't accept that. But I did have the sense. I did this one time in my life that I was suddenly extraordinarily fluent, and I'm never fluent. I wrote those 5 pages as if I heard a voice. In a sense, I have no entitlement to this part because it's an experience in a death camp. I was not there. I did not experience it." Unquote. The Shawl is particularly admired for its compactness. In only 2,000 words, Ozick evokes the horrors of the Holocaust while touching on the varied themes of survival, motherhood, nurture, prejudice, and betrayal and emptiness. So then, let's go on a tour de force into Cynthia Ozick's The Shawl. Stella. Cold, cold, the coldness of hell. How they walked on the roads together, Rosa with Magda curled up between sore breasts. Magda wound up in the shawl. Sometimes Stella carried Magda, but she was jealous of Magda, a thin girl of 14, too small, with thin breasts of her own. Stella wanted to be wrapped in a shawl, hidden away, asleep, rocked by the march, a baby, a round infant in arms. Magda took Rosa's nipple and Rosa never stopped walking. A walking cradle. There was not enough milk. Sometimes Magda sucked air. Then she screamed. Stella was ravenous. Her knees were tumors on sticks, her elbows chicken bones. Rosa did not feel hunger. She felt light, not like someone walking, but like someone in a faint, in a trance, arrested in a fit, someone who is already a floating angel. alert and seeing everything but in the air, not there, not touching the road, as if teetering on the tips of her fingernails. She looked into Magda's face through a gap in the shawl, a squirrel in a nest, safe. No one could reach her inside the little house of the shawl's windings. The face, very round, a pocket mirror of a face. But it was not Rosa's bleak complexion, dark like cholera. It was another kind of a face altogether. Eyes blue as air, smooth feathers of hair, nearly as yellow as the star sewn into Rosa's coat. You could think she was one of their babies. Rosa, floating, dreamed of giving Magda away in one of the villages. She could leave the line for a minute and push Magda into the hands of any woman on the side of the road. But if she moved out of line, they might shoot. And even if she fled the line for half a second and pushed the shawl bundle at a stranger, would the woman take it? She might be surprised or afraid. She might drop the shawl, and Magda would fall out and strike her head and die. The little round head. Such a good child, she gave up screaming and sucked now only for the taste of the drying nipple itself. The neat grip of the tiny gums, one mite of a tooth tip sticking up in the bottom gum. How shining! An elfin tombstone of white marble gleaming there. Without complaining, Magda relinquished Rosa's teeth, first the left, then the right. Both were cracked, not a sniff of milk. The duct crevice extinct. A dead volcano, blind eye, chill hole. So Magda took the corner of the shawl and milked it instead. She sucked and sucked, flooding the threads with wetness. The shawl's good flavor, milk of linen. It was a magic shawl. It could nourish an infant for 3 days and 3 nights. Magda did not die. She stayed alive, although very quiet. A peculiar smell of cinnamon and almonds lifted out of her mouth. She held her eyes open every moment, forgetting how to blink or nap, and Rosa and sometimes Stella studied their blueness. On the road, they raised one burden of a leg after another and studied Magda's face. Aryan, Stella said, in a voice grown as thin as a string. And Rosa thought how Stella gazed at Magda like a young cannibal. And the time that Stella said, Aryan, it sounded to Rosa as if Stella had really said, let us devour her. But Magda lived to walk. She lived that long, but she did not walk very well. Partly because she was only 15 months old, and partly because the spindles of her legs could not hold up her fat belly. It was fat with air, full and round. Rosa gave almost all her food to Magda. Stella gave nothing. Stella was ravenous, a growing child herself, but not growing much. Stella did not menstruate. Rosa did not menstruate. Rosa was ravenous, but also not. She learned from Magda how to drink the taste of a finger in one's mouth. They were in a place without pity. All pity was annihilated in Rosa. She looked at Stella's bones without pity. She was sure that Stella was waiting for Magda to die so she could put her teeth into the little thighs. Rosa knew Magda was going to die very soon. She should have been dead already, but she had been buried away deep inside the magic shawl, mistaken there for the shivering mound of Rosa's breasts. Rosa clung to the shawl as if it covered only herself. No one took it away from her. Magda was mute. She never cried. Rosa hid her in the barracks under the shawl, but she knew that one day someone would inform, or one day someone, not even Stella, would steal Magda to eat her. When Magda began to walk, Rosa knew that Magda was going to die very soon. Something would happen. She was afraid to fall asleep. She slept with the weight of her thigh on Magda's body. She was afraid she would smother Magda under her thigh. The weight of Rosa was becoming less and less. Rosa and Stella were slowly turning into air. Magda was quiet, but her eyes were horribly alive, like blue tigers. She watched. Sometimes she laughed. It seemed a laugh, but how could it be? Magda had never seen anyone laugh. Still, Magda laughed at her shawl when the wind blew its corners, the bad wind with pieces of black in it that made Stella's and Rosa's eyes tear. Magda's eyes were always clear and tearless. She watched like a tiger. She guarded her shawl. No one could touch it. Only Rosa could touch it. Stella was not allowed. The shawl was Magda's own baby, her pet, her little sister. She tangled herself up in it and sucked on one of the corners when she wanted to be very still. Then Stella took the shawl away and made Magda die. Afterwards, Stella said, "I was cold." And afterward, she was always cold. Always. The cold went into her heart. Rosa saw that Stella's heart was cold. Magda flopped onward with her little pencil legs, scribbling this way and that in search of the shawl. The pencils faltered at the barracks opening where the light began. Rosa saw and pursued. But already Magda was in the square outside the barracks in the jolly light. It was the roll call arena. Every morning, Rosa had to conceal Magda under the shawl against a wall of the barracks and go out and stand in the arena with Stella and hundreds of others, sometimes for hours. And Magda, deserted, was quiet under the shawl, sucking on her corner. Every day, Magda was silent, and so she did not die. Rosa saw that today, Magda was going to die. And at the same time, a fearful joy ran in Rosa's two palms. Her fingers were on fire. She was astonished, febrile. Magda, in the sunlight, swaying on her pencil legs, was howling. Ever since the drying up of Rosa's nipples, ever since Magda's last scream on the road, Magda had been devoid of any syllable. Magda was a mute. Rosa believed that something had gone wrong with her vocal cords, with her windpipe, with the cave of her larynx. Magda was defective without a voice. Perhaps she was deaf. There might be something amiss with her intelligence. Magda was dumb. Even the laugh that came when the ash-stippled wind made a clown out of Magda's shawl was only the air-blown showing of her teeth. Even when the lice, head lice and body lice crazed her so that she became as wild as one of the big rats that plundered the barracks at daybreak looking for carrion, she rubbed and scratched and kicked and bit and rolled without a whimper. But now Magda's mouth was spilling a long, vicious rope of glamour. "Ma!" It was the first noise Magda had ever sent out from her throat since the drawing up of Rosa's nipples. "Ma!" Again, Magda was wavering in the perilous sunlight of the arena, scribbling on such pitiful little bent shins. Rosa saw. She saw that Magda was grieving for the loss of her shawl. She saw that Magda was going to die. A tide of commands hammered in Rosa's nipples. Fetch, get, bring. but she did not know which to go after first, Magda or the shawl. If she jumped out into the arena to snatch Magda up, the howling would not stop, because Magda would still not have the shawl. But if she ran back into the barracks to find the shawl, and if she found it, and if she came after Magda holding it and shaking it, then she would get Magda back. Magda would put the shawl in her mouth and turn dumb again. Rosa entered the dark. It was easy to discover the shawl. Stella was heaped under it, asleep in her thin bones. Rosa tore the shawl free and flew. She could fly. She was only air into the arena. The sun heat murmured of another life, of butterflies in summer. The light was placid, mellow. On the other side of the steel fence, far away, there were green meadows speckled with dandelions and deep-coloured violets. Beyond them, even farther, innocent tiger lilies tall, lifting their orange bonnets. In the barracks, they spoke of flowers of rain. Excrement, thick dirt braids, and the slow stinking maroon waterfall that slunk down from the upper bunks, the stink mixed with a bitter, fatty, floating smoke that greased Rosa's skin. She stood for an instant at the margin of the arena. Sometimes the electricity inside the fence would seem to hum. Even Stella said it was only an imagining, but Rosa heard real sounds in the wire, grainy, sad voices. The farther she was from the fence, the more clearly the voices crowded at her. The lamenting voices strummed so convincingly, so passionately, it was impossible to suspect them of being phantoms. The voices told her to hold up the shawl high. The voices told her to shake it, to whip with it, to unfurl it like a flag. Rosa lifted, shook, whipped, unfurled. Far off, very far, Magda leaned across her air-fed belly, reaching out with the rods of her arms. She was high up, elevated, riding someone's shoulder. But the shoulder that carried Magda was not coming toward Rosa and the shawl. It was drifting away. The speck of Magda was moving more and more into the smoky distance. Above the shoulder, a helmet glinted. The light tapped the helmet and sparkled it into a goblet. Below the helmet, a black body like a domino and a pair of black boots hurled themselves in the direction of the electrified fence. The electric voices began to chatter wildly. Ma, ma, they all hummed together. How far Magda was from Rosa now, across the whole square, past a dozen barracks, all the way on the other side. She was no bigger than a moth. All at once, Magda was swimming through the air. The whole of Magda traveled through loftiness. She looked like a butterfly touching a silver vine. And the moment Magda's feathered round head and a pencil legs and balloonish belly and zigzag arms splashed against the fence, the steel voices went mad in their growling, urging Rosa to run and run to the spot where Magda had fallen from a flight against the electrified fence. But of course Rosa did not obey them. She only stood. Because if she ran, they would shoot. And if she tried to pick up the sticks of Magda's body, they would shoot. And if she let the wolves screech, ascending now through the ladder of a skeleton breakout, they would shoot. So she took Magda's shawl and filled her own mouth with it, stuffed it in and stuffed it in until she was swallowing up the wolf's screech and tasting the cinnamon and almond depth of Magda's saliva. And Rosa drank Magda's shawl until it dried. So that was Cynthia Ozick's The Shawl for You, portraying the cruelty of man on man with a certain unexplainable visceral resonance. Reading it for you here has been heartbreaking for me all over again. Motherhood is bafflingly difficult, not to mention the testing times. The Shawl was reprinted in 1989, paired with Rosa, a novella that picks up the tale of the same characters some 3 or 4 decades later, when Rosa and Stella are refugees in America. And though they left Poland long ago, neither can escape memories of the Holocaust. Ozick says, quote, "I wrote the second half because I wanted to know what happened to Rosa afterward. I was curious to enter the mind of such an unhappy, traumatized person and see how that person would cope with the time afterward. Rescued, saved, safe, and yet not rescued, not safe, not normal, abnormal." Unquote. While the Shawl portrays the characters' grief, guilt, loneliness, hopes, and dreams, Rosa, the novella, is about the importance of remembering, of bearing witness, and of listening to the lessons of history with our ears and our hearts. That'll be all for today's episode. Do get in touch and tell me what you enjoyed most about this episode. What do you think about the story? What do you think about motherhood, especially in such troubling times as these? I would love to know your thoughts. Thank you so much for joining in. Be sure to tune in for another episode of Reading Reveries next week. Until then, keep well and have a good day.